And there are fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So again, let us you can say interact with each other. Okay, keep your videos on. Okay, if you are comfortable. Okay, so let us be more and more interactive, and let us clear all our doubts. Okay, during our class itself. Okay, good to see some of you. Okay, but all of the rest, hope you have got out of your bed. Okay. Okay, all right. Let us get started. So in the last class, we just started with India and Afghanistan relations. Okay, Afghanistan, as you know, it is in news, and a very probable question, a very expected question. Okay, what is the implication on India because of the US withdrawal? Okay, so even you might get a essay as well. Okay, maybe for 125 marks on refugee crisis, on issues such as like the migrations, maybe between the countries, why the migrations are happening, the human right violation, okay, or rise of non-state actors, okay, rise of extremism or terrorism itself. Okay, these are like a very expected, you can say, even essay. So whenever you are preparing, ensure that you do have a lot of content with you so that you would not be searching for the content. Okay, in addition to that, IR, very very probable. Okay, but like try to, you can say, understand the India Afghanistan relations from different perspective. Maybe in your history paper it can be asked. Okay, like maybe the Anglo-Afghan wars. Okay, the why Anglo-Afghan wars are important. Okay, what is the trace, the history of that? Okay, or it can be asked in your you can say current affairs. Okay, maybe different places they might give in Afghanistan. Okay, arrange these places in north to south order, east to west order, because a lot of places in Afghanistan are in news. Okay, hope you are aware about not only the Kabul, okay, but also about a lot of other areas in news, like Mazar-e-Sharif or Zaranj, Herat, okay, Kandahar. Okay, hope you have heard of all these names. Okay, if not, like take a map and be very much clear on the geography of Afghan. Okay, all right. Now, in the last class, we also discussed about the background of Afghanistan. Okay, we discussed that is a country which has always been the center of great games, and we also discussed that why all the great games are concentrated around Afghanistan. Okay, because of the geostrategic location, and most importantly, none of these empires could conquer Afghanistan. Okay, either from Alexander to recently USA. Okay, now why it happened, we don't know. Okay, it is like a mystery. Okay, or it could be just coincidence. Okay, either of the things, we do not know. But however, what we know is the Afghanistan has not been conquered. In fact, Afghanistan is called graveyard of empires. Graveyard of empires. Okay, the reason being, like, whichever the empire would try to strike Afghanistan, that would be the last, you can say, territory which can be conquered. Okay, for that particular empire. Okay, that's where it is called graveyard of empire. Okay, so we noticed it from Britain to Soviet Union to USA. Okay, now USA is no longer a hegemon. Okay, US is being challenged by even smaller countries like Iran, okay, or smaller countries like North Korea. Okay, now this is the situation the US is in. Okay, all right. Now, we also mentioned about why peace and stability is important in Afghanistan. Okay, now, write down. In the last class, we just started with this. Why stability? Stability in Afghanistan is important for India. Why stability in Afghanistan is important for India? Is important for India. I can see only few of you. turning on the videos. What about the rest? Any challenge you face? Do you face any bandwidth issue or maybe background noise, you think? Okay, but if not, like, let us turn the videos on. Let us interact with each other, at least see each other. Okay, at least we'll be disciplined in getting up in the morning, okay, and freshening up. Right? Okay. Gnaneshwar, I don't see your video. Akhil, Sunni, Megha, Lalita Sri. Okay. Gagan, I still don't see your video. Okay. Please turn on your videos, all of you. Okay. If not, if you have any problem, just put it in the chat box if you do have any specific problem. Okay. Good to see all of you in the morning. Okay. All right. Let us get started. So list out first one, historic. Historic. Cultural. Cultural. Strategic. I can make a table like this. Strategic. Security, economic. Okay, security, when I say security, it is internal security point of view of India. Economic. Economic. And the Pakistan angle. The Pak angle. Okay. So if possible, try to divide this one further. Like in ancient Indian history, from medieval Indian history and modern Indian history. Okay. Internal security, you can further divide into the problems of terrorism, okay, which are emanating from Pakistan, which are emanating from Afghanistan itself. Okay, so try to further divide so that you'll be having a lot of points with you. Okay, because probably in your mains exam, one of these can be a full-fledged question. Okay, because you might need to be writing 200 words only from one particular perspective. Okay, evaluate the importance of Afghanistan from historical perspective of India. Okay, or evaluate the security crisis which the recent events in Afghanistan are unfolding for India. Okay, or evaluate the strategic concerns India has, okay, with respect to the instability in Afghanistan. Okay, got it. Like each of these, like what we are going to discuss, can be a full-fledged question. So ensure that you do have a lot of content with you. Okay, again, you need to do a huge amount of brainstorming. Okay, brainstorming, where would you do? Not in the exam hall. Okay, but before the exam itself. Okay, you have to get all the points at one place so that you are prepared. Okay, now what differentiates a candidate who writes good answer and who writes bad answer? Okay, where do you brainstorm? Okay, a smart student would brainstorm beforehand. Okay, he would have thought of these kind of questions and he had prepared the right content with him. Okay, now those students who could not clear, what is the problem? For the first time, they are getting surprised, okay, in the exam hall. Okay, so I would suggest get surprised beforehand, okay, before the exam hall, so that you are more and more prepared during the actual exam. Okay, now you can write down historical. Okay, starting from Mauryan Empire. Starting from Mauryan Empire. Again, you need to substantiate with facts. Okay, it is not just writing Mauryan Empire. A lot of Ashokan edicts, the edicts of Ashoka, a lot of Ashokan edicts are found in Afghan region. The edicts of Ashoka. Okay, the edicts of Ashoka are very important inscriptions to reconstruct Indian history. Okay, when I say India, the Indian subcontinent, which includes Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Afghanistan as well. Okay, now this is one of the very important sources for an ancient Indian historian. okay, ancient Indian history. Okay, if someone is aware, can someone put it in the chat box in which language they were, in which script and which language they were written in Afghanistan region?
Kharosthi language, sir. Kharosthi script.
Very good, very good. Kharosthi was script, okay, in which the Ashokan edicts are mentioned. Heard of it, the name Kharosthi? Okay, if not, you can just make a note. Okay, it is something like a script which is very much inspired by Persian. Okay, a script which is very much inspired by Persian. Okay, Kharosthi, Kharosthi. Okay, Kharosthi. Then you can mention about the Lodi dynasty. Okay, if you are aware, there was something called Delhi Sultanate, okay, which ruled India for more than 300 years. Delhi Sultanate, okay, which ruled India from 1206 to 1526 until the first battle of Panipat. Now the Delhi Sultanate comprises of five dynasty from Mamluk to Lodis. Okay, the last dynasty which ruled India, okay, of the Delhi Sultanate belonged to Afghan region, okay, the Lodis, from 1451 to 1526. 1451 to 1526. Okay, someone wants to speak, otherwise keep your microphones on mute. Okay, then during the Mughal Empire, there was a brief period of rule by a very famous ruler called Sher Shah Suri. Okay, 1538. Okay, his rule was very brief. Okay, in fact, it was like a period of 5 years. But despite his, you can say, the rule was very short, it is very important in medieval Indian history. Can anyone tell me what is the importance of Sher Shah Suri in Indian administration? Heard of the name?
Land reforms.
Okay, can anyone be more specific?
Sir, decentralized bureaucracy.
Okay. Decentralized bureaucracy.
Made a construction of a road from Afghanistan to India.
Okay, very good. Can anyone name what is that road called?
Grand Trunk Road, sir.
Grand Trunk Road, very good. Okay, heard of Grand Trunk Road. Now, why this Grand Trunk Road is so important? Why are we talking about it today?
It was also connecting to the Silk Route, sir.
Okay, connecting to
that connection to the Silk Route, and in the present time, the Belt and Road Initiative of the of China, mm-hmm, was also once upon a time the Grand Trunk Road.
Okay, very good.
They could establish direct relations with Central Asia and European regions.
Very good, very good. Okay, and also most importantly, the road which connects, okay, which connects Kabul, okay, to Chittagong. Okay, where is Kabul? Afghanistan. Where is Chittagong? Bangladesh. Now, what is important here to understand is, in those times, like somewhere in 16th century, it used to take 24 hours to reach Kabul to Chittagong. Is it clear? Now, what is something interesting to note is, even by today's standards, it would take about 24 hours by road. Okay, if you just take Google Maps and try to put Kabul to Chittagong, it would take about the same time. Understood the importance of it. That means almost 500 years before, he made the road with almost the same, you can say, standards as we would have made it today. Okay, in fact, today it is much worse. You need to cross Pakistan, okay, which is almost impossible, right? Okay, now this is something which is very interesting when we are talking about the integration of South Asia. Okay, today it is a distant dream. Okay, integrating South Asia and moving from one country to other country. Now, this is which was possible long before, during the rule of Sher Shah Suri. And he is also very much important. The rule of Sher Shah Suri is very much important, if you are aware. Because as some of you have pointed out, the bureaucracy, okay, the you can say a well-organized bureaucracy and a well-crafted revenue system. Okay, now these two would become the basis of the Mughal Empire. Okay, though even before Sher Shah Suri, there was advent of Babur and Humayun. Okay, but they did not have any, you can say, established system of revenue collection of bureaucracy. In fact, it was the foundation which was laid by Sher Shah Suri, which would become you can say the forerunner for the Mughal Empire in the future. Okay, the same system would be adopted by Akbar. Okay, one of the reasons why the Mughal Empire survived for so long. Okay, if you are aware that Mughal Empire was established in 1526 and it would rule India till 1857. Okay, until you can say the outbreak of revolt. Okay, till that point of time, the Mughal Empire would rule. One reason why Mughal Empire could rule India is because of its bureaucratic system and the revenue system. Is it clear? The foundations for this would be laid down by Sher Shah. In fact, many of the features of revenue system and bureaucracy would be adopted by later by the East India Company. In fact, many of the bureaucratic systems and revenue system today, what we have, are the same thing which is borrowed from the East India Company. Is it clear? Okay, if you trace back Indian bureaucratic system or Indian revenue system, the modern bureaucracy what we have, okay, the modern revenue system what we have, okay, they are having the roots from the Sher Shah Suri administration. Is it clear? This is the reason why we study about Sher Shah Suri, about the tax collection mechanism, the efficient administration. Okay, even by today's standards, it is a nightmare. I hope you are aware. Okay, this is what like the importance of Sher Shah Suri when we are talking about the history of India. Okay, you can quote him. Okay, in modern times, you can quote Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan. Heard of the name? Can anyone tell me who is this person?
Frontier Gandhi of India. Northwestern Province.
Northwestern Frontier Province. He was one of the few popular Muslim leaders who was against the partition of India. Okay. Now, if you recollect, like this was a part of Northwestern Frontier Province. Okay. NWFP, which was called the Pakistan region. And today what it is called the Khyber. Okay, today what it is called federally administered tribal regions, okay, and portions of Afghanistan were called as Northwestern Frontier Province. Okay, now he belonged to this region and he was a strong, you can say, follower of Gandhi, the Gandhian style of struggle. Okay, he adopted in this particular region. Okay, in fact, he was one of the few foreigners who was awarded the Bharat Ratna, right? Okay, if you are aware about the fact, very few foreigners would be decorated with Bharat Ratna, and he was one among them. Okay, who was the other foreigners who were given Bharat Ratna? Anyone is aware?
Mandela.
Okay, good. Nelson Mandela. Anyone else?
Mother Teresa.
She was. She became an Indian citizen. She was a naturalized citizen of India. Okay, she. Though she had the roots abroad, but she was a naturalized citizen of India. Okay, so when you're preparing for this particular aspect, so I hope you got how you need to prepare. Okay, when you're preparing for historic reasons, don't just mug up, because you might forget. Okay, but if you prepare in this way, you're not only preparing for your IR, but also you're preparing for your art and culture. You're also preparing for your ancient Indian history, medieval Indian history, modern Indian history. Okay, a lot of current issues. Is this clear? Okay, even if you get write a short note on Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, you would be having enough content with you. Okay, write a short note on Sher Shah Suri, on administration of Sher Shah Suri. You would be having a lot of content. Is it clear the way we are preparing for this? So spending some time here would be helpful for you to write better and better answers in your exam. Okay, so when you're preparing for a topic, ensure that you have a 360 degree view with you, something like this. Okay, all right. Any questions before we move forward? or anything you wanted to add? Okay, I'm just giving you the roadmap, how to prepare your notes. Okay, then you can write cultural. Cultural. Okay, Afghan is a perfect country. Perfect country. To display India's soft power. To display India's soft power. Soft power. Okay, what is soft power? Anyone? You heard of the word soft power?
Diplomacy.
Diplomacy. Any other? Okay, let me ask you a simple question. What is power?
Your power is the ability of a person to control another person irrespective of their will.
Okay. Okay, it is more of a person level. We are talking from the international relations perspective. Okay, that's correct. The power
is authority.
Yeah. Is a ability to control. Ability to control, okay, or influence other countries. Why are you doing this? For your own benefit. Okay, for your own benefit. The ability to control or influence the other country for your own benefit, that's what we call it as power. Okay, now the power is a very important concept when we are talking from polity perspective, politics perspective, because the politics start with power and they end with power. Okay, what is the ultimate goal of politics? It is power, right? Power is a means and power is the end. Okay, and a very important concept when we are talking from politics perspective or from international relations perspective. Okay, it could be a local politics, it could be a national level politics, or it could be an international level politics. Okay, the you can say the definition would remain same. It is the ability of one group or one party to control the decisions of other party. Okay, for the benefit of yours. Okay, not for the benefit of others. Now, there are different types of powers. Okay, what we are trying to understand is hard power and soft power. Hard power and soft power. Now, what is hard power? Hard power of the country is to use the economic might, or it is to use the strategic might of a country, okay, to arm twist. Okay, a classic example is China. Okay, China uses economic might. This is what we call checkbook diplomacy. Okay, I think we were discussing about it. Okay, what is checkbook diplomacy? Like Xi Jinping goes to Nepal with a checkbook in his hand. Okay, he would write a checkbook. Okay, he would write a check to that country, and that country would turn towards China. Is it clear? This is by economic arm twisting of the country. You are influencing the decisions being made in Nepal for China's advantage. Is this clear? This is what we call economic, using the economic might, or using your defense forces. Okay, classic example is Russia. Uses this kind of approach. Okay, Russia uses its defense forces to arm twist small countries in its neighborhood. Okay, like Ukraine or Slovenia or Romania. Okay, all these countries, they would try to arm twist using the defense forces. If you don't turn towards Russia, then Putin would send one or two missiles over you. Okay, is it clear? This is what which happens by using your defense forces. You are threatening other country. Okay, if you are using any other approach apart from economic might or military might, it is called soft power. Is it clear? So hard power is more of a force, okay, whereas soft power is more of attraction. Attraction. Now, a classic example of attraction is USA. Okay, classic example of this one, soft power, is USA. Now, take the example of USA. A lot of countries aspire to be USA. And what is this? See, which country is the most hatred enemy of USA today? China. or Iran or North Korea. Okay, all these countries are strong enough to cushion USA. But what you see here is lot of people from China wanted to go to USA. And notice this. Why is it like that? It is a soft power or the attraction of USA. Okay, it could be anything. It could be because of the democracy, which is there in USA. Okay, it could be because of the multinational corporations. Okay, lot of multinational corporations which are there in USA. A lot of best universities in the world are there in USA. Have noticed this? Okay, almost all in any field you take. Okay, almost all the best universities in the world are in USA. Almost all the best MNCs, okay, in the world are in USA. Okay, almost you can say no other country could guarantee so much of democratic rights. Okay, the people who are harassed by their respective states, okay, they try to migrate to USA. Almost all the political activists, okay, or human rights activists have noticed this. Now, whatever could be the reason, okay, there would be, you can say, attraction of USA. Okay, or you can say Hollywood. Hollywood itself is a classic example where the Hollywood movies are watched in almost all the countries. Have noticed this one. This is what we call it as, or English, take the case of English. Okay, despite today we are talking about American English, not the British English, right? Okay, be it language, be it culture. Okay, the culture of USA, almost everyone tries to follow. Okay, now this is what we call it as attraction. Okay, or this is what we call soft power. Now, US does not only use soft power, but also it uses hard power. Is it clear? To influence other countries. Okay, this is a classic example of the diplomacy of US. Understood what is hard power and what is soft power? Hard power is the economic might or military might of a country. Or soft power is by using some kind of attraction. Okay, so that countries on their own join. Okay, a country, for a classic example of using only soft power, is Japan. Okay, maybe you would have heard in news, like the people of Japan are so much disciplined. Okay, people of Japan are so much of a patriots. And notice this. Okay, nowhere you would hear bad things about Japan. Okay, throughout your media. Okay, whatever the media you are taking about. Okay, how Japan is industrialized, how Japan is developed. You would see only positive news about Japan throughout your media. And notice this. Hardly you would see negative news about Japan. Okay, this is what Japan, why is it like that? Okay, just like the companies do branding, Japan also do some kind of branding. Okay, there is a separate ministry to do this kind of branding for soft power of Japan. Is it clear? Now, China does not have the same soft power. Russia does not have the same soft power. But India has soft power. Is it clear? That means a lot of countries, you can say, they look towards India for its democracy, okay, for its thriving economy, okay, for a lot of other areas like culture, like spirituality. Okay, this is where India is having some kind of soft power. And Afghanistan is one such place where we can display our soft power, because India's soft power is pretty famous in countries like Afghanistan. Okay, because Afghanistan is a country which aspires or look towards India, okay, for building up its institutions, okay, or maybe you can say the culture of India is something which influences Afghanistan a lot. Okay, so you can talk about the soft power which can be used in countries like Afghanistan. Okay, this is a perfect opportunity for us. Okay, then you can write. Can anyone tell me what is the institution in India to project soft power? If anyone is aware, if not, put it in the chat box.
Sir, is it Incredible India?
That's a campaign. That's more of a campaign. Now, what is the institution? What is the institution which is mandated to project soft power of India?
A tourism
ministry? No, it's not a ministry. I'm giving a clue. It's not a ministry. Let's try to find out what is that. Institution. Yeah.
Ministry of Culture.
No, it's not a ministry. So Ministry of Culture would be having a lot of mandate, but one particular institution is having a specific mandate of projecting soft power of India. Okay, just try to find out If not, I'll give you the answer. Maybe remind me if you could not get it. Okay, all right. Next, in the cultural, you can write. The Pashtun diaspora, P-A-S-H-T-U-N. Okay, lot of Pashtun diaspora, okay, who are called Pathans. Okay, they live in India. Okay, they originally belong to Afghanistan. And Afghanistan is also a place where there are remnants of Buddhism and Sufism. Remnants of Buddhism and Sufism. Okay, maybe in your ancient Indian history, you would read something about Gandhara School of Art. Heard of this Gandhara School of Art? This is around the Pakistan and Afghanistan region today. Okay, very famous school of art from your art and culture perspective. Okay, so if you see Afghanistan, it is having a lot of cultural ties with India. Okay, all right. Then coming to the strategic, okay, right, few points. Strategic. India has approximately 100 kilometers of land border. Okay, officially we are having border. That's what we discussed. Okay, if you look at the map of Afghanistan, okay, this particular border I'm talking about. Okay, if you see the official map of India, we can see that there is a border with Afghanistan. Okay, but Pakistan occupied this particular region. Okay, this is in POK today. Okay, however, we are talking about the officially we do have border with Pakistan. So when you're writing your answer, you have to be writing that fact that we do have the border with Afghanistan. Okay. Then we discussed about the strategic location of Afghanistan. Okay. Because Afghanistan is at the crossroads. Okay. And having a rule, which is, or a regime, which is favoring India is always good. Okay. For India. Next point. You can write projects such as INSTC, Chabahar and Tapi, TAPI. Okay, we'll discuss about these projects in detail. Okay, for time being, you can note of Chabahar, INSTC, and Tapi. Okay, the success of these projects would depend on the ultimate happenings, okay, which would take place in Afghanistan. Okay, the success of all this project would depend on Afghanistan. We'll discuss why. Then, Afghanistan is at the crossroads of, or is it the tri-junction of China, Pakistan, and India? Afghan is of tri-junction of Pak, China, and India. And we know that Pakistan, India, and China, all the three are nuclear powers. Okay, what is something important is all three are nuclear powers, and they do not share a very friendly history. Okay, that's what we discussed, like India, Pakistan, or India, China. Okay, we do not see a very good past history. Okay, now any kind of conflict or any kind of instability, okay, can become a spark, okay, for a full-fledged nuclear war. okay, for a full-fledged nuclear war. That is where a stable Afghanistan is so important for the peace in Asia. Okay, it is not only from India's perspective this is important, but the whole region perspective. Okay, because any conflict which is triggering the three countries, okay, which do not have a very good track record, okay, in the past, okay, might trigger into a full-fledged nuclear war, which is the most dangerous thing in the region. So if you look from external security perspective, Afghanistan is so important. The stability in Afghanistan is so important. Okay, and from internal security perspective, it is even more important. Okay, we need not talk more on this, because Afghanistan has become like a hotbed of terrorism. Okay, it has become like Mukherjee Nagar for terrorist aspirants. Okay, just like all IAS aspirants in the India, okay, goes to Mukherjee Nagar. Hope you are aware about Mukherjee Nagar. Heard of it? Okay, very famous place in Delhi. Okay, where you get almost all coaching centers at one place. Okay, now this has become like Mukherjee Nagar for terrorist aspirants. Okay, that means the terrorists across the world. Okay, from Norway to Sweden to India to Malaysia, whoever wants to join a terrorist organization, the best country they can go is Afghanistan. Okay, where they have almost all the franchises. Okay, like Al Qaeda to IS to Taliban. Okay, they have almost all the options to join one or the other. Is it clear? Now we can see that a regime like Taliban in Afghanistan, okay, might be a security nightmare for India. Okay. Because Taliban, we do not know how it would react to, because we do not have any prediction, okay, with the regime of Taliban. Okay, had it been some kind of democratic government, we can predict it, we can make a deal with it. But a non-state actor like Taliban, because in the past, we do not have a very good track record with Taliban. Okay, hope you are aware about the hijack of the Indian aircraft. Okay, in Kandahar, if you are aware about that, during the Taliban regime only, okay, it happened. Okay, Masood Azhar was released. Okay, he was, you can say, there was the IC-814 airline which has been captured by the Taliban, and later, as a hostage situation, we need to release Masood Azhar out of the prison. Okay, if you are aware about that fact. Okay, now, what we need to understand is, from internal security standpoint, a instable Afghanistan is a security nightmare for Indian forces. Okay, at any point of time, okay, at any point of time, all these, you can say, the Islamic extremist forces, okay, might target a country like India. Okay, why India? Because we know that Pakistan is a Islamic country. That is what at least people believe. Okay, or at least people who are in the extremist version, they believe the story of Pakistan. And China is a hard country. Okay, we know that penetrating into China is very difficult. Now, if they want to show some success, okay, there could be a soft target like India. Okay, this is what which happened in 1990s. Okay, when the Soviet Union disintegrated, a lot of, you can say, the non-state actors, they entered POK, and which caused a huge amount of security crisis in India. Okay, if you are aware about a law called AFSPA, heard of it? Armed Forces Special Powers Act, okay, which was enacted in 1990. Okay, why armed forces would be enacted, the Armed Forces Special Powers Act would be enacted in 1990 for Kashmir? The reason is the Soviet Union disintegrated, a huge amount of non-state actors entered into POK, okay, which became a security nightmare where the local police or BSF could not prevent this issue. Okay, that's where we need to enact the Armed Forces Special Powers Act. Okay, because in the past we had that history, okay, of dealing the security crisis here, which itself was a huge security complication for India. Okay, till today we know that what is the situation in Kashmir. Okay, what is the situation in Kashmir? Well, most of this is traced back to 1990s. Okay, similar situation might arrive. Okay, at POK. Okay, this is where we are so much cautious about the security, internal security concerns of India. Okay, clear. Then we can also talk about the drug trade. Okay, because of the Golden Crescent. Okay, I think we discussed about what is Golden Crescent. Okay, a huge amount of the opiate drugs, okay, are produced and trafficked in these regions. Okay, now the drug trade is something like MG Narega for Taliban. Okay, so a lot of people are being employed in this. Okay, in fact, like the you can say the drugs have become like a medium of exchange. Okay, so for a lot of non-state actors in the region. Okay, this is again a concern for India. Maybe again these kind of drugs getting trafficked into India would be a concern. Okay, if you are talking from internal security point of view. Okay, there could be money laundering. There could be you can say crossing of the borders. Okay, in the name of drugs. So all these can be security challenges Indian forces need to face. Okay. Then from economic perspective, right now. Economic perspective. India already invested. India already invested. In lot of projects in Afghanistan, such as okay, again we need to substantiate, okay, with facts. Zaranj Delaram roadway, Zaranj, Zaranj, Delaram, Delaram roadway. Okay, if you look at the map, okay, this is a Chabahar port, which is in Iran, a very strategic project for India. Okay, and further to from Zaranj to Zahedan. Okay, and from Chabahar to Zahedan, and from Zaranj to Delaram. Okay, this is a very important project for making inroads into Afghanistan. Okay, India has already constructed this project, but again, the construction of this project came with a huge cost for India. Okay, if you are aware about a lot of security personnel, okay, lost their lives in construction of these projects. Okay, in addition to a huge amount of funding which went into. Okay, we need to secure these kind of projects which India has already built in Afghanistan. Okay, you can mention about the Garland Road. Okay, this Zaranj Delaram roadway would further connect to the Garland Road in Afghanistan. Okay, you can mention the Garland Road connecting Mazar-e-Sharif and Herat. Via Delaram, Kandahar, and Kabul. Okay, so as I told, like all these places are very important. Okay, maybe in your prelims, sometimes you might get a match the following type of questions. Okay, match the following: Gwadar, Chabahar, Zaranj, Delaram. Okay, China, Iran, Pakistan, Afghanistan. Which countries they are correctly located, okay, identified. Or you might get a question like, which of the following places are not located in Afghanistan? Okay, maybe they make you 4 to 5 places and ask you to pick the place which is not there in Afghanistan. Okay, or they might give the places like this and ask you to arrange in north to south order or east to west order. Okay, these kind of questions are very popular in competitive exams. Okay, so be very cautious about all the places. Okay, do remember it. Okay, if possible, maybe take a world map. Okay, take a map or take a atlas and try to identify these places in the map or an atlas so that it would be easier for you to recollect. Okay, and you can see this particular map. This map shows the importance of these projects. Okay, we discussed that Afghan is a landlocked country. Okay, because it is a landlocked country, it need to heavily depend on Pakistan for its trade. Okay, we discussed that just like Nepal, just like Bhutan, okay, they need to heavily depend on India for their trade. Okay, in the same way, Afghanistan had to heavily depend on Pakistan for its trade and its external contacts. Now, why India is doing all these projects? so that an alternative route can be made into Afghanistan. Is it clear? So Afghanistan need not depend only on Pakistan. It can depend on Iran and India. That's what the idea of developing all these projects. Is it clear? Okay. So the you can say the future of all these projects is at stake. Okay, because of the emerging security crisis in Afghanistan. Okay, someone would blow themselves up. Okay, go to their dam. Okay, go to the dam which India is constructing. Okay, this is Salma Dam. Okay, hope you are aware about the dam India is constructing here. Okay, someone might go here and blow themselves up. Okay, a Taliban or any other fighter. Okay, this is what which happens. Okay, in these countries. Okay, so it is a economic challenge for India. Okay, a economic challenge for India. Again, we are substantiating with all the facts. Okay, when we are talking about economic this one. Okay, in India. We are talking with examples. Okay, we are talking about Delaram Saranj Highway. We are talking about the Garland Highway. We are talking about the construction of dam. Okay, and if you are aware that the parliament building of Afghanistan is also constructed by India. Okay, the parliament building. Again, I'll show you. Okay, maybe you can draw if you want. You can make note of some other projects. The parliament building in Afghanistan. The parliament building in Afghanistan. Power plants and universities. Power plants and universities. Okay, a lot of other projects. Again, a lot of other projects like hospitals, schools. Okay, in addition to what the infrastructural projects India is constructing. Okay, could anyone get what is that? Soft power institution. Okay, if you want, you can write down. It is ICCR, Indian Council for Cultural Relations. Indian Council for Cultural Relations. Okay, the institution to project India's soft power. Okay, you might get a full-fledged question only on ICCR. Okay, take this as an assignment. Indian Council for Cultural Relations. Okay, I hope like we got enough points for us to write in the economic aspects. Okay, again, the way we are approaching the question is by substantiating our answers with lot of facts. Okay, we are not just writing that Afghanistan is important or stable Afghanistan is important, but rather we are substantiating with facts. Okay, then from Pakistan angle, you can write. Okay, why from Pakistan's angle Afghanistan is so important? Because Afghanistan shares a huge border, an unresolved border with Pakistan. Okay, if you are aware, I think we discussed about yesterday that this line, what is this line called between Pakistan and Afghanistan?
Durand line.
Durand line. Okay, because of unresolved Durand line. Because most of the Durand line is not resolved between Pakistan and Afghanistan. Okay, what Pakistan is to India, Afghanistan is to Pakistan. Is it clear? Okay, just like Pakistan is, we are talking about, it is a security challenge for India. In the same way, Afghanistan is for Pakistan. Now, enemy is a friend. Okay, now why Afghanistan is so important from India's perspective? Because if we do have good relations with Afghanistan, okay, very good relations with Afghanistan, in the case of a war between Pakistan and India, Afghanistan can be used as a second front. Okay, you can write down. Afghanistan can be used as a second front to counter Pakistan. Okay, now Pakistan is also aware of this problem. Okay, that's why Pakistan ensures that whatever the regime which is there, okay, would not have good relations with India. Okay, you can write down. Pakistan always wants strategic depth, put it in quotation marks, strategic depth in Afghanistan. Okay, what is strategic depth? Okay, to put it in layman terms, strategic depth is nothing but a regime which supports Pakistan. That's it. Okay, Pakistan does not really care who comes to power in Afghanistan, but Pakistan is more caring about that power should be anti-India. Is it clear? Okay, either it is democratic government, either it is non-state actor. Okay, what Pakistan only believes is a puppet kind of government which would be anti-India in its approach. This is what Pakistan wants, in short. Okay, to put it in a more diplomatic way, it is called strategic depth. Pakistan always wants, it says officially that we need strategic depth in Afghanistan. Okay, this is what India does not want to happen. Okay, because for us with Afghanistan, we do not have any you can say historical animosity. Okay, in fact, we are having good, you can say, track record in the past, okay, except in the recent times. This is what India always looks forward to, make Afghanistan as an ally. Okay, if you look purely from Pakistan, okay, hope we got lot of points for us. Okay, this is how you prepare your notes. Okay, so when you prepare your notes, not more than half your page. Okay, you would not write story. Okay, rather you would try to create a framework. Okay, and within this, you would add the points. Okay, now if you prepare like this, you would be having enough amount of points, in fact, more than what is required for the exam. Okay, so any kind of question, you would be having enough content, okay, to frame your answers with. Okay, how you formulate the answer, how you structure the answer, that we see at a later date. But what is more important is having the right content with you. Okay, because most of the time students struggle to get content. Okay, or students end up writing the same words, okay, the same sentences again and again. Okay, but if you are having a lot of content with you like this, then I think it would be easy for you to write any kind of answer in the exam. Okay, any questions on this particular slide?
Sir, for internal security, we basically covered two aspects, right? Like the drug trade with respect to the Golden Crescent and the insurgency problem. That's it, right?
Right. So we would not call insurgency. We would call it as terrorism. Okay, because the word insurgency, we would reserve it for Northeast. Okay, though in common parlance, the terrorism, insurgency, we use interchangeably. Okay, but when we are talking strictly from internal security standpoint, we call, you can say, the terrorism in Northwest, and in Northeast, we call insurgency. Okay, I think that's pretty much terrorism and drug trade. And we can also add a lot of other things related to money laundering. We can add something like the terrorism, that you can say the training camps of this one, but more or less they are related to terrorism only. So I'm not explaining more into that, but I think these two are the two broad areas in internal security.
Okay, sir.
Okay, any other question? Okay, all right. So moving forward to the discussion. Can I write the word? the background of, or you can write in this way, reasons for present crisis in Afghanistan. Reasons for present crisis in Afghanistan. Reasons for present crisis in Afghanistan. Okay, again, we need to be very much aware the way you can say the Afghanistan, the crisis which has been unfolded, okay, way back in 2001. Okay, why exactly the you can say the US forces, US and its forces attacked Afghanistan, and what exactly are the challenges. Now, to understand this, we need to go back a little amount in history, okay, that is post World War II. Okay, post World War II, we know that there has been a bipolar world which was created. Okay, one led by USA. This is what we call bipolar world. Okay, and one led by Soviet Union. And during this bipolar world, it is characterized by a war called Cold War. Okay, if you are aware, maybe in your world history, you would learn more about it. Okay, the period between 1945, okay, after the you can say end of World War II, and until the disintegration of Soviet Union, this was a phase of bipolar world, which is characterized by something called Cold War. Okay, that US and Soviet Union, they always tried to maintain their hegemony in the world. They wanted to show that we are the superpower, okay, both US and Soviet Union. Okay, in 1991, Soviet Union disintegrated, and this created something called a unipolar world order. Okay. Until 1991, it was a bipolar world where it was characterized by Cold War. Now, during Cold War, there would be a lot of indirect conflicts which US and Soviet Union would enter. Okay, one of the important conflicts which would happen is in Afghanistan. Okay, now to understand this one, we need to just to understand the events which are happening in a broader perspective. Okay, just be attentive here. Okay, because a lot of events would unfold. Okay, which is which would help us to understand the issues in Afghanistan in a much better way. Okay, now what happens is in 1970s, okay, this was a phase of what we call detente. Okay, detente means easing of tensions. Okay, we discussed this. Okay, because during the phase of detente, the India-China relations also started improving. Okay, that means many people expected, or many scholars expected, that US and Soviet Union would come closer. Okay, because they were trying to make some signs of progress. Okay, make some signs of progress where US and US Soviet Union are coming closer with each other. However, by the end of 1970s, okay, the situation went completely, you can say, against. Okay, these converging interests, these converging areas where US and Soviet Union were coming together, suddenly they disappeared. Okay, a lot of events would happen suddenly. Okay, for example, you can write down the revolution in Iran. Okay, Iran, there was a puppet regime of USA. Okay, there was a rule of Shah. Okay, who would be, you can say, who would be loyal to USA. Okay, but suddenly in 1978, there would be Iranian revolution. And 1978 was also a period which would witness a very important accord called Camp David Accord. Okay, we will discuss this one in maybe in Israel and Palestine show. Okay, Camp David Accord. Now, during this Camp David Accord, what would happen is the Israel would be recognized as a state by many countries in West Asia. Okay, we'll discuss about the Camp David Accord. Okay, the Iranian Revolution and Camp David Accord, they were setbacks for USA. Now, Soviet Union would take this one as a opportunity, and Soviet Union in 1979 would invade Afghanistan. Okay, if you want, you can write. In 1979, Soviet Union, Soviet Union invades Afghanistan? Invades Afghanistan in the backdrop of Iranian Revolution and Camp David Accord. In the backdrop of Iranian Revolution and Camp David Accord. Camp David Accords. Okay, that means just 1 year before, US has suffered a huge setback, okay, for its hegemony in West Asia. Now, the Soviet Union feels that this is the right opportunity for me to prove my presence in West Asia. This is what which would take place in 1979. Soviet Union would attack Afghanistan and it would invade Afghanistan. Is it clear? Now, US is in no mood or no, it does not have enough resources to fight Soviet Union in Afghanistan. Okay, because if you look at the map of this one, okay, Iran is no longer a, you can say a pole of US. Okay, now US is in a dilemma how to deal with Soviet Union in Afghanistan. Now, when you cannot fight a direct battle, what would you do? You would fight an indirect battle. Okay, simple. What Pakistan does to India, if it cannot fight a direct battle, it would fight an indirect battle. Okay, an asymmetric warfare. The same thing US would do here. Now, what US would do is it would train a group of soldiers. That is what the CIA, okay, the CIA and the US agencies, what they do from the background is they create a something called a Taliban means student. Okay, the literal meaning of Taliban is student. Okay, they create a group of youngsters who would fight back against the Soviet invasion. Is it clear? Okay, now the Taliban would be given a mandate, okay, or given a this one that they need to fight against Soviet Union, who are godless people. Understood this, okay? Because this is how the US would project Soviet Union, okay? Now, in this backdrop, US would give funding, US would train this, but not directly, okay? It would train through this route, okay? Now, if you try to understand the dynamics, the Taliban would be trained in Pakistan, okay? Now, one country which is willing to train all these people to give them some kind of moral support, okay, with the help of ISA and with the help of army in Pakistan, the Taliban gets their training. Okay, and who would give the funding? The funding would come from Saudi Arabia. Okay, now why Saudi Arabia would fund for this kind of movement? Okay, because the Saudi Arabian rule is under US control. Okay, what Saudi Arabia would get in return? A huge amounts of arms and ammunitions. Okay, what US would get in return? Everything for free, including oil. Are you getting the dynamic? Okay, so what US would be getting in return? It need not spend a single rupee. It would find a huge market of arms and ammunitions in Saudi Arabia. What Saudi Arabia gives in return is oil. In addition to that, it would also give funding to Pakistan so that the Taliban gets trained in the madrasas of Pakistan. Are you getting this one? And to whom against they are fighting for? They're fighting against Soviet Union. Okay, are everyone clear about what happened in 1979, 1980s? Any questions still now? Okay, now fast forward to 1991. In 1991, Soviet Union in a very dramatic situation, there was a disintegration of Soviet Union. Now, US felt that there is no need to fund these kind of movements. Now, what US would do, US would stop the funding through the Saudi Arabia. Now, Saudi Arabia would no longer provide the funding. Okay, now the Taliban would be, you can say, completely in a dilemma. They do not know what to do. Okay, now they realize that we are not supported by Pakistan. We are supported by Saudi Arabia. In fact, we are supported by USA. Now, from now onwards, the Taliban feels that the people who cheated us is USA. From then on, the Taliban became anti-USA. Are you getting this point? Okay. Now, USA did not realize the, you can say, the threat posed by Taliban until it was in 2001. Okay, where one of the offshoots of Taliban called Al-Qaeda, okay, would conduct the 9/11 attack on US. Okay, after the 9/11 attack, the US response would be swift, and they would, you can say, capture Afghanistan with the help of NATO forces, even without the UN consent. Okay, the NATO forces would invade Afghanistan, and they wanted to, you can say, respond to what happened in 9/11 attack. Okay, now if you want to just make a list of, you can say, the US and Taliban relations. Okay, just to make like a flowchart. Okay, from 1979 to 1991, from 1991 to 2001, from 2001 to 2014, from 2014 to 2021. Okay, just make it list like this. During this time, US was supporting Taliban. Okay, 79 to 91. Okay, because until the Soviet disintegration, okay, because US felt that this is, you can say, here. Okay, if you know the map of this one, okay, this is what Soviet Union is. Okay, because all the Central Asian republics were part of Soviet Union. Okay, until 1991. So it wanted to create the, you can say, the US wanted to create a force which would try to attack Soviet. But later US regretted it. Okay, what US felt that to kill the python, I created a lot of small snakes. Okay, these small snakes started biting USA post 1991. So from 1991 to 2001, US had neither good relations nor bad relations with Taliban. But post 2001, okay, until 2014, the relations between US and Soviet Union were completely, you can say, in against. But in 2014, there was a complete reversal of US policy against Taliban, okay, after the London conference. And US and Taliban make some progress that we are together. Okay, but there was a lot of uncertainty which happened post this. Okay, there are some offshoots of Taliban which made, you can say, deals with USA. And within USA also, there was a lot of dilemma. Okay, even Trump is more, you can say, mercuric in his approach, okay, to deal with Taliban. But you can say, we do not know what kind of relationship it was. There was a lot of uncertainty which happened. Now, the kind of question you might get is, post 2001, what would be the relations? Okay, if you see the trend, in short, we do not know. Okay, because the US policy itself is not very clear when we are talking about Taliban. Okay, is this clear? So in your note, just prepare something like this. Okay, so that instead of writing the whole story, this should be in your mind. Okay, whatever the backdrop which is happening here. So in when you're writing in your exam, okay, you need not write all this. Okay, because this is all, you can say, confidential information. We do not know for sure. Okay, US says, I have not funded it. Okay, Taliban says they have funded it. Soviet Union says they have, the US has funded Taliban. US created Taliban. Okay, Pakistan, we do not know what it says. Okay, now that is where when you're writing your answer, instead of writing all this, you have to write in a more diplomatic way. Okay, that is, the US policy towards Taliban is not very clear. Okay, there is an uncertainty in US policy against Taliban. That's it. Okay, the examiner would understand the background. But all the story is clear. Once this background is clear, you might be able to write better answers, and you might be able to understand the articles in a better way. Any questions till now?
Sir, what about Ahmad Shah?
Ahmad Shah Abdali? Who, or who? Which Ahmad Shah? The president or CEO?
No, sir. No. Panjshir.
Ahmad Shah Massoud.
Of Taliban?
No, Panjshir area.
I'm not aware.
Revolution.
There is a anti-Taliban protest is going on, sir, which is led by the vice president of Afghanistan and the former anti-Taliban fighter's son, Ahmad Shah Massoud, I think, is his name.
Okay. I'm not really aware.
The only region that is not felt for Taliban until now is Panjshir Valley, in past and present, during Soviet war also.
Oh, okay. I'm not aware. Thank you.
The Panjshir Valley.
Panjshir Valley?
Yes, sir. Panjshir Valley.
Okay. Oh. Thank you. I'll try to find out, maybe in tomorrow's class, I'll just try to see. Okay, if this is something important. Okay. All right. So moving forward. Okay, moving forward. Now, what is the question? What is the question India has? Okay, now the type of questions which can be asked is, what is US policy? What is China's policy? What is Russia's policy? And what is Pakistan's policy? Okay, then we'll come to India's policy towards Taliban. Okay, any other questions or anything you wanted to add? Okay, all right. You can write down the US policy towards Taliban. US policy towards Taliban. Okay, you can write first one. The withdrawal of forces. The withdrawal of forces. Okay, the withdrawal of NATO and US forces from Afghanistan. Led to the collapse of the elected government. Led to the collapse of elected government. And allowed Taliban to dominate the country. And allowed Taliban to dominate the country. After about 20 years of a long drawn battle, US wanted a honorable exit from Afghanistan. Okay, so this event, what we see today, is not completely unexpected. Okay, from 2014 onwards, there were deals with Taliban, okay, which US was maintaining it. Okay, since the London conference, which I was talking about in 2014, for the first time, US would completely reverse its policy that till that point of time, it is saying anti-Taliban, but suddenly it would make a U-turn. US would make a U-turn because US has its own share of challenges. Okay, because if you see 1950s USA, okay, what is the enemy of USA in 1950s? It was only one, Soviet Union. Okay, what is the enemy of USA in 2001? Maybe it is Afghanistan. Okay, what is the enemy of USA in 2008? China. Okay, China became a huge economic threat for USA post the recession. Okay, if you see the trend of relations, okay. Now, post 2014, US started having a lot of challenges to deal with it. Okay, internal and external challenges. Okay, even with traditional allies, okay, those countries which it thought to be traditional allies like Japan, okay, allies like EU, allies like Canada or Australia, they also started demanding their due share. Okay, now what we need to understand is the Trump's policy, okay, the Trump policy is just, you can say Trump is making a lot of noise, okay, but US policy has always been fluidic. Okay, what the other presidents have done it more, you can say, more, you can say, diplomatic way. What Trump has done in a more noisy way. That's the only reason, only difference between the Trump and Obama. Okay, because since the time of Obama, the fluidic policy of USA created a lot of ripples within its allies itself. Okay, and also new threats started emerging, like Iran became a threat for USA. North Korea became a threat for USA. Okay, in addition to that, a lot of other countries, okay, which it thought were no longer a challenge, they started waging, you can say, the different types of threats for USA since 2014. Now, simply put, the enemies for USA has changed. Okay, new enemies were created. Now, because of this reason, US somehow wanted to withdraw from Afghanistan. Okay, from 2014 onwards, the withdrawal has already started. In fact, though there was US presence in Afghanistan, it was mostly in and around the Kabul region. Okay, apart from that, the rural parts of Afghanistan has already fallen to Taliban, which was not so much, you can say, publicized. Okay, what we are seeing today is just the publicity of Taliban taking over. Okay, what we need to also understand is it is not something which started, which instantly happened in 2021. Okay, it started happening since 2014 onwards. By 2014 itself, US realized that keeping Afghanistan together comes with a lot of cost, which would not be useful. It is just a misuse of funds. And Trump, to put it in this way, he made it very clear. Our purpose in Afghanistan is not in nation building. Our purpose in Afghanistan is killing terrorists. Okay, now we have killed a lot of terrorists. Now we'll go back. Is it clear? The way the US president is saying it. Okay, though he put it in a more, you can say, blatant way, that is what it is. Okay, US is no way interested in building Afghanistan, rebuilding Afghanistan, because it is just an economic burden for it. What it is more interested is killing the terrorists and show to their people that we have done some action. Okay, because of its domestic politics. Okay, this is what we need to be aware of. Okay, so from 2014 onwards, US wanted some kind of honorable exit. Now, what do we mean by honorable exit? It means that US is a very capitalist country. Okay, it does not really care about what people of Afghanistan thinks. Okay, it has spent something like $10 billion of US military and its equipment, which it wanted to withdraw, or it wanted to sell to their nearby countries, including India. Is it clear? Because US has deployed a lot of, you can say, the arms and ammunitions, which somehow it wanted to create a market in the nearby region, including India, which India made a lot of deals as well. I hope you are aware. US-India defense relationship has started increasing. Why? Because of, you can say, the post-2014, US somehow wanted to sell as much equipment as possible and take back as much equipment as possible and leave whatever it is, go back. That's what US wanted. This is what, in realistic terms, honorable exit is. Is this clear? Okay, what US and its allies wanted. Okay, so to have an honorable exit, the US and its NATO allies, okay, started some kind of peace talks with Taliban. Okay, some were fruitful, some were not so fruitful. Okay, is this clear what US wanted? In short, US just wanted only honorable exit so that its arms, ammunition, or its people are safeguarded. Okay, nothing more than that. Now, US policy is very much clear that we want killing of terrorists. And at least on paper, we killed here and there a lot of terrorists. Okay, we are happy about it. We will go back. This is what the US policy in short. Okay, any questions? Okay, now what is China's policy? You can write. Okay, China is always a free rider in any kind of crisis. Okay, China knows. Okay, because it is a free rider. Okay, it wanted to take advantage of the situation. Okay, be it in Pakistan. Okay, be it in Myanmar, be it in Sri Lanka, be it in Maldives. Now, China always wanted to exploit that situation, okay, for its own interest, okay, including the Afghanistan crisis. Now, you can say, China is more worried about the investments in Pakistan. Okay, in brackets, right? CPEC, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. And further extension of BRI into Afghanistan. Now, China wanted to make the current crisis in its favor, okay, and probably it want to extend the BRI, okay, it wanted to extend the BRI into Afghanistan as well, okay. This is what China wanted. At least it wants some kind of assurance from Taliban that we would not attack the CPEC corridor, because China has already made a huge amount of investment. So simply put, US is very clear on its policy. China is also very clear on its policy. Okay, now Russia. Come to Russia. is in the pursuit of great power. Russia is in the pursuit of great power. Great power. And believes Taliban is a lesser evil in the region. And believes Taliban is a lesser evil in the region. Can anyone tell me what is greater evil for Russia?
USA?
No.
China?
No. No.
Europe?
No. No.
NATO?
NATO, no. Come on. What do you think is a greater evil for Russia? Okay, Islamic
capitalism.
Okay, Islamic state. Okay, you can write down Islamic state. IS. Okay, again, we are not writing it. We are saying that what Russia says, that Taliban is a lesser evil. See, it is not a good thing. Taliban is also an evil, but it is much better than Islamic state taking over Afghanistan, which is much worse. This is what Russia feels because its interests in West Asia, okay, either in Syria or in Yemen or in Iran, okay, they are more threatened with Islamic state rather than Taliban. Okay, so Russia is more than happy to assist Taliban. Is it clear? Because somehow it wanted to prevent, as some of you rightly pointed out, NATO forces is a threat for Russia. Okay, direct threat for Russia. Taliban is not a direct threat for Russia because it can be able to deal with Taliban easily. Okay, so somehow Russia wanted to support Taliban. Okay, because the interests of Moscow are different. Okay, and from Pakistan's angle, okay, very straightforward, okay, not so complicated. Okay, because Pakistan knows what it wants. Okay, what Pakistan knows, in short, it needs some kind of regime which is always anti-India. Okay, now at least for Pakistan, there is no, you can say, dilemma. Okay, Pakistan is very clear in its thought that whatever regime which comes, it should be anti-India. And also, you can write down, the biggest fear for Pakistan is creation of greater Pashtunistan. The biggest fear of Pakistan is creation of greater Pashtunistan. Okay, if you see this particular region, okay, between Pakistan and Afghanistan, okay, both the sides of the border, both the sides, it is heavily dominated by the Pashtun population. Okay, heavily dominated by Pashtun population. And this is a worst security nightmare for Pakistan because it is already having a lot of internal challenges. Okay, that's what we discussed. Okay, including the regions of Balochistan. Okay, now in this situation, a creation of, or the, you can say, movements for greater Pashtunistan, okay, would be a biggest fear for Pakistan. Okay, so Pakistan does not want a regime which supports these kind of movements because there is always a ethnic conflicts in Pakistan. Okay, that's what we discussed. There are Shia Sunni conflicts, there are language problems, okay, like Punjabi and Sindhi problem is already there. Okay, then there are a lot of other sectarian challenges which are already there. On the top of it, any, you can say, challenge for greater Pashtunistan, including the Khyber province, including the federally administered tribal areas, okay, this would be a huge security threat for Pakistan. Now, to challenge all this, now what Pakistan does, it would try to maintain a distinction between Taliban. Okay, for Pakistan, there are two Talibans. Okay, in Pakistan's language, it is called good Taliban and bad Taliban. Okay, good Taliban are those who would support Pakistan in its anti-India campaign. And bad Taliban are those people who are calling about greater Pashtunistan. Is it clear? Okay, this is where Pakistan would say good terrorist and bad terrorist. Okay, this is what India was saying repeatedly. Okay, there is no good Taliban or bad Taliban. The Taliban is a Taliban. Okay, good terrorist or bad terrorist, they do not exist. Okay, terrorist is a terrorist. But often what Pakistan does, it would favor the good Taliban to fight the bad Taliban. Okay, this is what you can say the Pakistan's policy towards Taliban would be support to as long as it is anti-India. Okay, as long as it is calling for greater Pashtunistan, now Pakistan would become this one, unfriendly with Taliban. Is it clear? What is Pakistan's policy towards Taliban? Okay, it is having a clear this one. If you are pro-Pakistan, we would support. If you are anti-India, we would support. But if you are anti-Pakistan, we would not support it. Okay, that's what the Pakistan's policy in short. Now, the more confused out of all these major powers is India. Okay, we discussed that. Okay, we discussed that US is having a clarity on its thoughts. Okay, what it wants. China is having a clarity in its thoughts, what it wants. Russia is having a clarity. Pakistan is having a clarity. Who does not have clarity is India. Is it clear? India is so much confused what to do. Okay, now you might get a question on this one. What should be India's policy towards Taliban? Is it clear? Okay, should India maintain ties with Taliban or should India sever the ties with Taliban, which would be good for India? Now, this is a matter of debate. Okay, I hope with all the facts, all the information you have, I think you would be able to write a better answer on your own. Okay, so take this as a small assignment. What should be India's approach towards the Taliban regime? What should be India's approach? Okay, towards Taliban regime. Okay, maybe in exam, the UPSC language might be more, you can say, flowery language. Okay, it might, you might get a more better question, but this is what the gist of the question would be. Okay, what should India do? Okay, what should India's policy? Should India restrict its role? Okay, or have you can say a minimal, you can say, engagement with Taliban? Or should India train the forces so that it would be in a position to fight against Taliban? Or some scholars are even going to an extent of saying that, okay, India should conduct some operation, okay, defeating the Taliban and establishing or re-establishing the democratic regime. Okay, because what they say is sooner or later we need to face Taliban. Okay, sooner or later, maybe they might attack India. Okay, instead of waiting for them to attack India, okay, should India be, you can say, instead of like just responding to the situation, because you need to fight the battle sooner or later, okay, either in Kashmir or in Afghanistan. So if you have to choose, better make the battleground as Afghanistan itself. Okay, because the security implications would be more if we wait longer, if we make Taliban to grow further. Okay, then let Taliban attack India, then we are fighting it. It would be more disastrous for India. Rather, India should take a call now itself, should go and fight the Taliban now itself. This is one more, you can say, thoughts. So like two extreme thoughts. One is, you can say, India should make close ties with Taliban. Okay, one way, India should send its forces to attack Taliban, kill Taliban. Okay, some kind of Dabang style of operation, come back. Okay, or the middle path, which Indian government often adopts, wait and watch. Okay, let the things unfold. Okay, only if it is a threat for India, then we'll respond. We'll see what to do. Okay, which approach India should do? Should India engage with Taliban? Should India be more, you can say, patient enough to see the events unfold in Afghanistan? Or should India make Afghanistan as a battlefield and prepare itself for the attack, okay, before the events go out of control? Okay, instead of making India as a battlefield, okay, let us make Afghanistan itself as a battlefield where the casualties would be less. Okay, Understood it? The three approaches or the three options India has. Good relations, okay, completely opposite relations, okay, or a more diplomatic approach of wait and watch. Okay, maybe your answer can be one of this, but you have to always touch all the three options what India is having. Okay, and if there is any other option, okay, if you can find any other option, maybe from your own research, try to write it as well. So the examiner would get an impression that you have thought about it. Okay, it is not that you are writing only from one perspective. This is something you can, maybe there could be pros and cons of each one. Okay, so what approach you take, okay, depends on your own analysis. Okay, so it is no single answer because we do not know. Okay, but whatever the you can say the side you are taking, you need to substantiate with the pros and cons of others. Okay, had India been taking this one, these could be the positives, these could be the negatives. Okay, or these could be the positives and these could be the negatives. Again, try to prepare a lot of content. Okay, because as I told, just don't write India should do this. Okay, write why India should do this. Why not the other options are possible? Okay, based on a thorough analysis, okay, you have to write your answers. Is this clear? What should be India's approach? Any questions till now? Okay. So hope we are good with Afghanistan. We got enough points to write in your exam. Okay, few other maybe prelims based questions. You can write. Okay, few other places and other things which are in use. First one. The China's military bases in Afghanistan. Okay, we know that China is very fond of trijunctions. Okay, like India, Nepal, China, or India, Bhutan, China, or India, Myanmar, China, India, Pakistan, China, okay, or Afghanistan, Pakistan, China. Okay, the trijunction is called Wakhan Corridor. Wakhan Corridor. It is in use because recently China has set up a military training base. Military training base. And we know that for China also, this is a highly turbulent region, okay, because of the Xinjiang province. Okay, we discussed that China has its own share of problem, okay, of fighting with the Uyghur rebels. Okay, so any kind of instability in Afghanistan is something bad for China also. Okay, and Pakistan also has its own share of problems, okay, including Baloch, including Pashtun. Okay, for Pakistan also, stable Afghanistan is good. Even for Russia, stable Afghanistan is good. Even for India, stable Afghanistan is good. So, in short, for all the countries, a stable Afghanistan or a peaceful Afghanistan is something good, which they cannot afford to ignore. That is the way you have to mention about the role played by Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Okay, again, take a small assignment. The role played by Shanghai Cooperation Organization to bring stability in Afghanistan. Okay, write down. What is Shanghai Cooperation Organization? Okay, an organization set up in 2001. To resolve border issues, fight terrorism, bring regional stability, and counter external powers in the region. and counter external powers in the region. Okay, external powers in brackets, USA. Okay, we know that. So when you're writing your answer, you should be more diplomatic. Okay, instead of writing USA, you can write external powers. Okay, so the examiner would understand. Okay, because what US has done, US has destroyed Afghanistan and simply walking away. Okay, is it clear? Now India cannot walk away. India need to deal with all the mess the US has created. Is it clear? Okay, because for US, it can simply walk away. Okay, but India cannot walk away because we are very close. Okay, any unforeseen incidents in happening in Afghanistan, a security threat would be for India. It would be for Pakistan. It would be for China. But what is happening in the past is we do not trust each other. India does not trust Pakistan. Pakistan never trusts India. Okay, because there are trust issues, because of there are like other challenges like border conflicts. And because of that reason, we are calling you, the countries like USA to bring stability in the region. Okay, now this is what the country has realized lately, that until we cooperate with each other, okay, because these are our challenges, we need to fight for our own challenges. Okay, we cannot wait for some other country to come and establish peace in the region. Okay, that is what the purpose of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Okay, so it consists of all the country, all the major powers, including China, India, Russia, and Pakistan, and four Central Asian republics, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, and Uzbekistan. Okay, and Turkmenistan is not a part of it. We'll discuss why. Okay, but be aware that these are the eight countries. Easy to remember. Okay, because all these countries are more interested in Afghan stability. Okay, so when you're writing about Afghan stability, you need to definitely mention about the role played by Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Okay, so whatever we are doing in the case of Afghan, okay, it should be through the route of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Okay, because the SCO has been created with the same purpose. Okay, and if you see the organizational structure, okay, if you look at the organizational structure of SCO, there is you can say a wing called RATS, okay, regional anti-terrorist structure. If you look at the structure of SCO, you would look at something called regional anti-terrorist structure. Okay, the very purpose of this RATS is to fight against the terrorist movements, mostly in and around Afghanistan, because this is what the security concern for Central Asian republics, India, Pakistan, China, and Russia. Okay, so is it clear what is SCO? I hope we got some overview of what is SCO. Now you might get a full-fledged question, what is the role played by SCO so far, and what else it can do in the future? Okay, or even if the question is not directly asked, okay, ensure that you are mentioning the role played by SCO in your answers. So take this as a small assignment. Okay, any questions till now, or are we clear? Should be crystal clear of whatever we discussed till now.
Sir, one question, sir.
Yep.
Sir, can we say that China using the Shanghai Cooperation, it is creating some kind of neo-colonialism in the Central Asian regions, and by even using the checkbook diplomacy?
SCO is not about like infra or anything about neo-colonialism. It is more about security concerns. Yes, okay, sir. It is more about security concerns. Maybe you can tell the same thing when we are talking about AIIB, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, or when you are talking about NDB, New Development Bank, or the BRICS Bank. Okay, but this is something which is more related for regional stability. Okay, and again, all these organizations are voluntary organizations. Okay, India, it is voluntary joining. And that too, see, China alone cannot do all this. The reason is there are other major countries like India, major countries like Russia. Okay, so had it been only China and Pakistan or Afghanistan, maybe we can think that line. But there are other countries which are equally, you can say, challenging to China, like India, like Russia. Okay, and they do have their own foreign policies. They do have their own interests. So I think that argument does not hold very much good in this sense, neocolonialism, because China arm twisting Russia, China arm twisting India, it is a bit tough. I'm not saying it does not happen, because I don't think that can be the purpose of SCO.
No, sir. That's I'm aware that that's not the purpose, but China can use this platform like recent, since the Quad and the Quad Plus. Many times it has blamed India that its Quad is becoming India's NATO or NATO in the
Asian NATO.
Asian NATO.
Yeah.
Right. So like that right. way, there might be chances that it can influence the other countries too.
Yes. So it can be a bit far-fetched. The reason is the NATO is a more cohesive organization. Okay, where US decides, all countries follow. Okay, yes, but SCO is very far from that fact.
Yes, sir.
Okay, because once China decides something, India says why we should go ahead. Russia yes, says why I should go with China's approach. Because it is having equal, you can say, different countries, different perspectives. So it is a far-fetched claim that it is like a Asian NATO or SCO. Because it is, first of all, the countries do not have a completely converging objectives. Okay, here and there, they might expect that you can say stability in Afghanistan might be good for all of them. But how the stability should happen? And what exactly do we mean by stability? Again, Russia has its own version. India has its own version. China has its own version. PAK has its own version. Central Asian republics have their own version. So this is, I don't think that could be a situation anytime in the future. Okay, considering the differences or different interests all the countries possess.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's a good question. Maybe it could be a far maybe at a later date. Maybe if all of them become so close, then it could be possible. Like EU. Okay, yes, if sir. They become so close, then it could be possible. If they become like NATO, it could be possible. But today, in today's world, all the countries having the same interests. Okay, and acting in a cohesive manner could be a bit far-fetched.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Any other questions or any other thoughts? Hope all of us are very much clear. Again, no discussion is complete without you looking at the previous year questions. Okay, understanding the questions, then only we'll be in a position to say that we have completed the topic. Okay, otherwise we just scratched the surface. Okay, again, don't think that the topic of Afghan is done. Okay, until you are able to write your own answer. Okay, the topic is not done. Okay, for me it is done. For you it is not done. Okay, so what I would strongly advise you to do is complete the assignments. Okay, if no assignments are given, again, the default assignment is previous year questions. Okay, look at previous year questions. Make your own notes. And ensure that you are also completing the topics parallelly. Okay. Otherwise, maybe within 1 or 2 weeks, we'll complete the IR. Okay. But you should also be on the same page. Okay. I think we covered India and South Asia in great detail. Hope you got some idea, except for Sri Lanka and Maldives, which I would, ask you to write your own maybe 1 or 2 pages of notes for Sri Lanka and Maldives. Submit it, okay? And then if you still have any questions, then we'll discuss. That would be more fruitful. Okay, in short, I'll make a deal here. If you submit assignments, I'll teach the topic. Okay, if you don't